Microphone. As we're waiting for our moderator, one quick announcement. A lot of folks are looking for the Internet Society's IoT paper. It's in your bag. It's on a postcard like this. And the URL is internetsociety.org/IoT if you're looking for their Internet IoT paper. Allison, thank you. And Matthew Hussey is making his way to the stage. For the folks at IAB, Alexandra and Peter, Matt does not work for the department that issues fines for colorful language at the FCC. He's in a totally different bureau, so he will not be issuing fines today. With that, let me introduce Matt Hussey. He's the Associate Chief of Policy for the Office of Engineering and Technology at the Federal Communications Commission. And he agreed to moderate a panel for us called Mobile Broadband, Keeping Up with Consumption. And I guess the question is, you know, assuming advertising, whether it's on Snapchat or elsewhere, looks like the future mobile is bright. Will we have the bandwidth to actually use Snapchat and all the other things that we've been talking about today? So let me just hand it off to Matt. Matt's been working on these issues for very long. Matt's an engineer. And when he was in the United States Senate Commerce Committee, he was the person I would always call to try to understand what's going on in this space. So Matt, let me just leave it up to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. Okay. Appropriately titled Mobile Broadband, Keeping Up with Consumption. And I'm joined on the stage with three people, obviously. Michael Calabrese, who's director of the Wireless Future Projects at New America Foundation. Edgar Figueroa, who's president and CEO of the Wi-Fi Alliance. And then also batting cleanup and great to join us with short notice, I guess I should say, is Allison Remsen with Mobile Future. Dominique Lazansky wasn't able to make it due to travel challenges, so we really appreciate Allison filling in on such short notice. And so as the kind of brief description talks about, you know, we're kind of really, and I also think it's kind of apt that Steve Case recently talked about the internet third wave, and we're kind of, and I've also heard that we're entering the golden age of wireless. There's just been an absolute explosion. As you can see, you know, there's just somewhat, I mean, the past three panels have talked about smart cities, you know, connected smart cities, talked about the Internet of Things, which Cisco, I guess, estimates about 50 billion, with a B, devices to be connected to the Internet by 2020, I think. And then also now we just talked about, you know, the increasingly evolution of mobile rich content or, you know, dynamic content of the internet and really trying to find additional revenue streams from that. So there's really going to be another, you know, continued explosion. And so I guess we just get right into it. You know, we're talking about this consumption. Obviously, you need networks and spectrum to provide connectivity for all that consumption. And I guess the question I would first pose to the three panelists is just, what is the current state of the broadband market? How does it look with, you know, these growing areas that are obviously consuming a lot of bandwidth? So I'll turn it over to, I guess, Edgar first, since he's to my right.
Sure. So one of the commitments that the organization I work with, Wi-Fi Alliance, has made is that we're going to do our best to stay ahead of demand. And we've been doing that for very many years. Many of you may know Wi-Fi has only been around for about 15, 16 years. And we have never secured any more spectrum than what was originally available for unlicensed use. And we started with 11 megabit per second speeds, and today we're over a gigabit per second. So one thing is absolutely getting more out of faster speeds out of the spectrum that's available. The other is optimizing more. So in using the same spectrum, we're able to get a lot more devices on the network in addition to dispatching the traffic much faster. And we maintain that legacy. There's a number of additional enhancements to Wi-Fi, including the next generation of Wi-Fi that are just in the horizon within the next few years that are going to continue to deliver generational improvements over the capacity and the speed of the Wi-Fi network. So we're in the middle of this. We're very committed to doing that. However, there's still also the spectrum crunch that we all hear about, and naturally we're right in the middle of that. So we suspect that over the next few years, Wi-Fi is going to be doing more with other spectral domains beyond 2.4 and 5, which have been the two places where Wi-Fi has traditionally played. So we're looking at 900 megahertz, which is already available. We're looking at additional spectrum that might be available in both 5 and 60 gigahertz spectral domains. And in addition, we've all heard about the possibility of spectrum sharing through different mechanisms, and that's something that we're working on as well.
Okay. Well, picking up from there, I mean, certainly this exponential growth in demand is very real. Mobile data traffic has increased by 60% year over year for the last 4 or 5 years at least, and is projected to continue more or less at that rate. And a 60% compound growth rate, you know, is just enormous. And even at this point, we're still not, I think, not quite to 70% take up of U.S. adults with smartphones, which means there's still room for growth there. So we'll have even more demand. And then there's the Internet of Things, the 50 billion devices as we begin to interconnect everything and want to use much more high bandwidth applications. So for example, video is already on mobile devices is heading towards 80% of bandwidth and growing. So, you know, some years ago, the former FCC chairman, Julius Genachowski, talked about a spectrum, not only a spectrum crunch, but in a different speech, a spectrum crisis. And I assume that was just his way of, you know, of putting, you know, putting some urgency to the issue. But, you know, he was saying that back in 2009, 2010, during the National Broadband Plan. And, you know, that crunch and that crisis never actually happened. And the main reason it hasn't, at least not yet, is the enormous carrying power that we found with Wi-Fi. So as Wi-Fi has, over unlicensed spectrum, has proliferated and has become basically every time you walk into a venue like this, which are even, I noticed, dispensing with passwords now in places like Starbucks, the Newseum, and so on, you are actually sending your data not over licensed spectrum to a tower and through your carrier that you pay $100 a month to, but actually at no marginal cost, a short distance at low power over unlicensed spectrum into the wire, into probably Comcast or Fios or whoever's providing the wireline connection. And I think most people are not aware that at this point, between 60 and 80% of all mobile device data traffic is going over Wi-Fi and over unlicensed spectrum. But as Edgar mentioned, something we're kind of running into now, you know, and even though it's years after Genachowski's warning, it will happen too, which is that even unlicensed spectrum is getting congested. We're running into real limits on what the 2.4 gigahertz band can carry, and there's some real delays in terms of opening up the 5 gigahertz band for unlicensed capacity and wider channels to carry that video. So actually, the government's very much, the FCC, the administration, they've been doing exactly the right thing. They've been making a mix of licensed and unlicensed spectrum available. They adopted a historic order last year, the new Citizens Broadband Radio Service. We can talk more about it, 3.5 gigahertz, which is a shared spectrum with the military, opening up capacity that's just really the beginning of that path. So they're doing the right things, but we're going to have to keep doing it and doing it faster and focus a bit more on unlicensed spectrum as well.
Allison. Yeah, so I represent an organization called Mobile Future that we're a membership-based organization. Our members include you know, large carriers, equipment manufacturers, and then a lot of app developers, and also nonprofit organizations that work in diverse communities who are often kind of seen as the first to cut the cord and are more heavily mobile adopters than kind of the rest of the population. So we've been, you know, very focused on spectrum issues for many years, and, you know, to go back to when Chairman Jenikowski talked about the spectrum crunch that we were all expecting in 2009, you know, I think that I think we've all experienced that kind of loading symbol of doom that for anyone trying to build a business in mobile or trying to complete a financial transaction or to communicate with a loved one, like there's, you know, there's definitely challenges that we're facing. And when he first launched kind of the push to make more spectrum available, back, you know, 7 years ago now, you know, we're just now kind of starting to see some of this spectrum kind of being repurposed for mobile, and it's a very lengthy process. And so, you know, we all are using our devices more than we ever dreamed of today than we did just 2-3 years ago. They're really now, you know, kind of the remote controls for our lives. We rely on them in untold ways, and you know, we've all seen the data. We're all streaming video more. We're seeing more uses of mobile for telemedicine and for payment options. And it's you know, become this really important piece of our everyday existence that we're increasingly seeing as kind of the mobile opportunity. You know, we're seeing huge growth in you know, kind of the app economy, and with folks who are embracing mobile in every aspect of entrepreneurship. So whether it's through financial tech or ed tech or digital health or using mobile for public safety, all of these uses for it, and in, you know, plus with IoT, which I'm sure we'll talk more about, with all of these 50 billion devices that are increasingly connecting to the networks, we can't just plan for today or tomorrow. We need to make sure, because of all of this increasing exponential growth in data traffic, that we're looking ahead to the future, to the mobile future, because it is bright and there is a lot of opportunity ahead. And it's really important that, you know, policymakers at every level are really focused on this and are looking at, you know, kind of consumers and their embrace of this technology, and knowing that, you know, here we are in a 4G world and we have, you know, have so much more ahead in this 5G world that we know is coming, but we can't quite identify exactly where it's going to take us. But given all of the potential ahead, we really need to make sure that we're focused on kind of our spectrum needs for that, and to make sure that we have the capacity going forward.
Thank you. And one question certainly in that the description of this panel touches on is, while the U.S. has certainly been the clear leader in the mobile broadband space, it's quite, I mean, the internet is global, and we've seen, you know, they're actually, globally, there are more mobile users than there are internet users. So we do see a lot of developing countries that don't have the wireline infrastructure that are using wireless as a way to provide connectivity to their citizens. And we've seen a lot of aggressive R&D investment and in other areas, specifically the Pacific Rim. And so I guess the question is, while we are the leaders and a lot of countries have looked to us, there are also a lot of countries that are chomping at the bit to surpass us. I know that while Verizon has, well, I'll actually touch on that later. I guess the two things I would highlight in regards to if our leadership is being diminished, and if we are possibly going to be dethroned, is first the National Science Board Science and Engineering Indicators report, which is released annually, has in the past stressed about our nation's leadership is being threatened, and they point to a couple different areas, such as I mentioned, R&D investment, but also, you know, you look at China and some other countries that are producing a lot more in India that are producing a lot more engineers than we are through our educational system. And then also there's, I guess, an annual report by a consulting firm called the Mobile Patents Landscape. And that indicated that the Asia, with respect to regions, Asia is actually outpacing North America and Europe in patent applications. And as a point to that, it should be noted that actually with the U.S. patents, 52% of those, that of the patents awarded here domestically, are of foreign origin, meaning to a foreign entity that has applied for a patent here. And so, and just to give you an example, back in 1980, that was only 38%. So we've seen this increase in innovation internationally. So I guess the question is, you know, is there cause for concern to policymakers in the industry about this, you know, growing competitiveness in the innovative space for mobile broadband internationally?
There are a lot of layers to your question, so I'll try to tackle a couple. There is absolutely a push in many regions. Asia Pacific is one of them, where there's an interest, a concerted effort to bring connectivity to the masses. In many instances, unlicensed spectrum and Wi-Fi in particular plays a prominent role. Whether it's a connected city or initiatives, through the public school systems all the way up to the higher education, because it's the most accessible way to connect, folks. It's economical to deploy. Most of these users already have devices, and it's sort of the most natural way to connect them. So that's sort of on the on the rollout front. As far as on the policy front, there is absolutely a lot of pressure globally to take the lead in terms of what policy facilitates the most innovation and puts a particular country or region in a prime position to innovate and take the lead. But look at, for example, the 5 GHz band is a prime example of that. We have a technology that still has a lot of upside with 802.11ac. This is today's version of Wi-Fi. We're tapped only maybe about half of the benefit that technology has yet to offer. For it to deliver its full capacity, more spectrum is needed because it operates in very wide channels, 80 or 160 megahertz. But yet in the U.S. in particular, we don't have a broad swath of spectrum that's contiguous and available to be used in that band. And other countries are looking at that very seriously. And it's a shame because, of course, the U.S. Led the way and set the example, back in the 80s by opening up unlicensed spectrum to begin with. And because of that, we've had a number of innovations that are examples of, innovations that came out of unlicensed spectrum and IEEE and the Wi-Fi community that then formed the basis for mobile. So it's absolutely something that needs to be sort of top of mind. And so the sort of the bottom line with that is that spectrum policy needs to be balanced. It needs to take into account, both connectivity for the masses that takes care of the needs today, but also has a long-term perspective towards nurturing an innovative environment. And there's still opportunity for the U.S. to, regain pole position on that front.
Yeah, well, I'm not overly concerned. I mean, when you look around, the U.S. Led the way with 4G, for example. We had, kind of the first and still have the most comprehensive deployment of 4G now virtually to the entire population, and enhanced mobile handsets. Nokia, of course, fell away quite a while ago to be replaced by Apple and by Android operating system developed by Google, and in many other areas and unlicensed technology, we continue to lead the world. I just think we just need to keep pushing on these things, and policy needs to keep pace with it. So, for example, we pioneered unlicensed access to the vacant TV channels, so-called TV white space. And yet that's got, in our country, that's gotten tied up in regulatory uncertainty, while the UK and some other parts of the world, Singapore and so on, have moved ahead with that to their advantage. And similarly, as Edgar mentioned, with the 802, the next generation Wi-Fi, 802.11ac, we still haven't opened up the remainder of the 5 GHz band so that could reach its true potential. And then the thing you hear the most about, this is the context this comes up now politically, is with respect to moving on to 5G, which is really represents not so much, not better coverage, but a densification of networks so you have very high capacity connectivity in places where people congregate, where you have dense deployments and that you can accommodate all these, connecting all these things from cars to refrigerators to security systems, in addition to people's smartphones. And on that, I think that's where a lot of the, you know, sort of the innovation race is right now. And we can lead the way there too. The FCC has a Spectrum Frontiers proceeding, which is quite far along already. There's already been comments and reply comments, lots of positions staked out. And my understanding is that the chairman expects to get an order out on at least part of that, at least some of that spectrum. In other words, these are like enormous wide bands of millimeter wave spectrum in the high frequencies that would accommodate these this 5G technology in the future. And I think the FCC, again, is leading on that, but they have to just keep at it so that we can be defining spectrum policy and mobile policy for the world rather than following the lead, because I think we've really in the U.S. have had the most progressive spectrum and mobile policy in the world.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that we're very fortunate where we are today with, you know, more than half of all of the LTE connections are here in the United States. We have been a leader because of smart policies that, you know, encouraged investment, encouraged, you know, the carriers to really go out there and put a lot of money in the ground and in the air and to, you know, build out these connections that we really kind of take for granted today. I think what we'll see going forward is there is a race on for 5G. We see South Korea, you know, aiming to have trials set by the 2018 Olympics, Summer Olympics, Japan also for the their Olympics in 2020. Europe is very focused on this, you know, in kind of not the not too distant past, Europe was really in the lead on 3G, and then the U.S. You know, our policy structures were much more encouraging for the significant investments we needed, and so we saw a huge boom here in the United States. And that is, you know, we can't take that lead for granted. We need to make sure that the policies in place are still encouraging all of this investment. This is a really expensive endeavor, and we're talking billions of dollars. I think last year, wireless network operators invested $28 billion in the infrastructure, and that's a lot of money. And so we need to make sure that, you know, going forward, that everyone kind of has their eye on the ball. Not that government or the U.S. government is kind of like driving this train, but making sure that any obstacles that could be in the way that could potentially deter investment or this network evolution, and really lets kind of the engineers who are working on this opportunity navigate the process so that we can continue to lead the world in wireless technology.
Okay, well, great. And I guess that's leads into my next question is, you know, when we're talking about, you know, trying to make more spectrum available, you know, the president has a goal, which I think a lot of people are very aware of in here, is to make 500 megahertz available by 2020. And it's one of the prime discussions at the biannual meeting between the FCC chairman and also the NTI administrator. And they just actually recently met, I guess, last month. And so I guess the question is, you know, is the administration doing enough in making more spectrum available? And then also, you know, one of the biggest concerns is, and I think you touched on it a little bit, Allison, is regulatory uncertainty. You know, that is obviously very detrimental. And so is the administration also doing enough, not only making more spectrum available, but also promoting greater investment, greater innovation, and removing those barriers so that the U.S. can be continue to lead when we talk about going, you know, evolving from 4G to 5G. So I open that up to all of you, because, you know, again, you're talking about 5G and the Internet of Things will be unlicensed, licensed, small cells, macro cells, et cetera. So
yeah, I could start, Matt, if you want.
Sure.
So, right, there's this. This was in the National Broadband Plan, and then in the President's executive order to have a goal of an additional 500 megahertz of licensed and unlicensed spectrum. And the administration is and the FCC are halfway there. I think the very good chance that they'll reach the goal, and it's important that they do. as far as, you know, you asked specifically about the administration as opposed maybe to the FCC, and so on that, I'd say, you know, there's some good points. There's some highlights and down points. I mean, the highlight, I think, which you all might not be aware of, is that the Defense Department, in particular, has just turned around 180 degrees in terms of its posture towards sharing spectrum with the private sector, because the federal government is actually the largest holder of spectrum, you know, of good spectrum, you know, below 6 gigahertz, and it used to be that that the federal agencies would take the same posture as private sector licensees, which is NIMBY, right? Not in my backyard, you know. Even though our radar system is maybe only using a tiny fraction of the potential bandwidth, we're not even going to talk to you about sharing. You know, our mission, you know, is the only thing we care about. But I think, you know, a lot of credit goes to the White House, to the President's Council of Advisors on Science and Advisors on Science and Technology, which put out a report that called for, you know, that the new normal should be sharing of spectrum that's underutilized, that you can work around these federal agencies in these bands. And the reality is, we keep talking about spectrum scarcity. In fact, with the right policy, we can have spectrum abundance, because not only these many of the federal bands, but also some of the bands that are licensed to the private sector many, many years ago, have enormous unused capacity. And so the military has actually embraced a posture now where where they're saying, basically, if you don't disrupt our systems, we'll share with you. And so that's proceeding, which is great. On the other hand, I think the White House has been too slow to intervene in these situations where there could be more sharing more quickly, but agencies are dragging their feet. The best example of that right now, you know, which we mentioned just a bit ago, the 5.9 gigahertz band. So the commission has proposed opening the whole 5 gigahertz band. Most of it would be shared with military radar, but there's a portion at the top of the band that had been assigned to the auto industry for auto safety and other things 16 years ago. It's not been used. And it's actually possible to share at least a good portion of that band with gigabit Wi-Fi. And really, it's a situation where the White House needs to sort of knock heads, you might say, between Department of Transportation and the FCC and reach a win-win compromise that gives the public, you know, both auto safety, if that's what transportation wants to do. They're considering a mandate for vehicle-to-vehicle signaling, and better Wi-Fi, which is quite possible without disrupting auto safety. So the White House just needs to be a little more aggressive in pushing what it's already started, but it's going down the right path in general.
I'll jump in. So, you know, from a policy perspective, like looking at spectrum, you know, the broadband plan was tremendous, and the president's memorandum on wireless was tremendous, but those were several years ago. And at this point, you know, this takes a long time to repurpose a lot of the spectrum, whether it's coming from the broadcasters today or the Defense Department tomorrow or other aspects of the federal government. This is a long-term issue that we're dealing with. And so the one piece that I think we need to make sure that our government is focused on it all in all parts of the city really is looking at not just the near term, but also, you know, planning for what happens after 2020, what happens when, you know, we get to 5G speeds that are carrying even more of our data and delivering it in faster speeds, more similar to the home experience that we have today. So this is, you know, this is a constant evolution here. And this is, you know, it's certainly in all of the above approach, whether it's unlicensed or licensed or sharing, you know, the other part of your question was really talking about certainty. And I think that we're seeing a lot of challenges in the sharing environment where, you know, some of the parameters that are set out there might not be long enough to really make a long-term investment. That's something that we really need to be focused on and making sure that this is working in every arena. The other part I would say, just you know, for those of us working in the internet space right now, The other big piece of uncertainty right now is what the court's going to do on the open internet proceeding. So, you know, this has been, we've seen a, you know, tremendous growth in the wireless sector from really, you know, the 1G world to get to 4G with very little government involvement. And the FCC's rules last year really took a very different turn for wireless, which is a very different, very competitive market. Any one of us today can go out and switch carriers and, you know, find someone, find a different provider if we're unhappy with our service. But for the first time, we're, you know, finding that wireless is now subject to Title II utility regulations. And, you know, there's still a lot that has to be figured out here. Everyone's kind of waiting with bated breath to see what happens in the courts in the next day, weeks, months, that's unclear. But, you know, certainty in an industry, in a sector that is so investment intensive is really critical. And I think there's some room for improvement.
So I'll just mention, coming back to one of the points that Michael, you made, in the Wi-Fi world, there absolutely has been a trend of exploiting traffic that we have been able to handle. And I think in part we've been lucky and we've been good, but the reality is we'd like to see even closer collaboration with policymakers, between policymakers and industry, to get some of the regulations spot on, right, so that there is no vacillation once the regulations get into place, that industry is ready to take advantage of that and implement into those new bands and frequencies that become available to the benefit of society. There's been a couple of examples where maybe, you know, we need to have continuing dialogue to make sure that that we get those those regulations clear enough. That there's minimal risk in implementing those in those frequencies. I'm thinking specifically of 3.5, for example, and TV white spaces, which have been mentioned. You know, here's an area where, to some extent, industry is a bit paralyzed because the regulations are not quite yet clear, and we don't industry would not move and make the types of investments that are warranted to take advantage of those frequencies if regulations are either subject to change or subject to be misinterpreted or don't deliver the Wi-Fi experience. To make a finer point of that, for example, in 3.5, there's a general access authorization as a part of that, but it's the exclusion zones and the amount of bandwidth for the channels that are available. We tend to think that the Wi-Fi experience is only allowed at 20 megahertz and above, but you know, the 10 megahertz are the channel widths that potentially could be available in the non-exclusion zones in that area. So there's a lot of that sort of dialogue that's needed to get to the finer points that would make for a suitable regulatory environment for industry to then step forward and take advantage of that. So there are absolutely still opportunities out there. Some of them are short term, but we do need, you know, more of that specific dialogue going back and forth to get to a place where the regulatory environment in the U.S. is favorable toward the innovation that we've seen from Wi-Fi the last 15 years.
And, well, I have a question, I guess, for Michael and also Allison. And Michael, you touched on it. The PCAS report back in 2006, you know, talked about possibly a new paradigm with, you know, sharing being kind of the big motivator to free up, or the main mechanism to free up more available spectrum from a federal standpoint. You know, you have the DoD National Spectrum Consortium, which is trying to bring the industry and the defense together to try to find ways to collaborate through sharing. Also, I think just a few weeks ago, DARPA announced a $2 million spectrum grand challenge, to where basically to look at sharing opportunities through the use of artificial intelligence and machine learning. So there really does seem to be a real shift from the administration, from defense, about sharing. I know the CISMAC has a bi-directional sharing subcommittee. The TAC sharing has certainly been a topic of conversation. And Allison, I mean, please correct me if I'm wrong, but certainly one of the mantras of the industry has been, hey, sharing's great, but we still need the, you know, clear an auction. So I guess the question, are we kind of on a tenuous situation where, you know, we do see the industry, I guess the federal government saying, hey, we're open to sharing, and how can we remove those barriers or the parameters that you had mentioned to provide greater long-term certainty from an investment standpoint? Because so I open that up to both of you on that, because, you know, it does seem a pretty interesting scenario.
I'll go first. I mean, this is definitely, you know, these are complicated issues. There's a lot of really, really smart, talented people who are working through all of this. I mean, from, you know, the carrier perspective, the industry perspective, there's definitely a focus on clearing because there is more certainty. There's more, you know, it's just a clearer path forward in dealing with sharing with government services, with, you know, sharing within government, sharing government to industry. It's a much more complicated, complex formula. And, you know, we recognize that, you know, there's sharing is definitely going to be a part of freeing up more spectrum because the government has so much of it. You know, there, it's something that, you know, we're watching very closely because of the need to make sure that, you know, if you get a sharing arrangement that, you know, doesn't give you kind of the peace of mind when you can go out and actually make the investment, then at the end of the day, a lot of this would be more, you know, a lot of work to not really get you to the desired goal or to the desired outcome. So, you know, I know, I think you're on PCAST, aren't you? You're on PCAST, yeah. So, yeah, I mean, it's definitely something that industry has always been focused on as an option, but, you know, from our perspective, we would much prefer to have a cleared band.
So, you know, we know that mobile carriers, such as Verizon or AT&T, T-Mobile, they, you know, they would, of course, prefer the traditional path they've taken, which is, you know, clear spectrum, which is exclusively licensed in an auction, it's wide area, and so on. But, you know, the primary problem with that is there's not much of it left to have, at least not in the, you know, what have been so far considered to be the good frequencies for mobile broadband. So we're having, of course, this big incentive auction. But after the incentive auction, this is the TV spectrum that's being, you know, auctioned this year by paying the broadcasters willing to give up their channel. After that, there's nothing really in the pipeline that's below 6 gigahertz. It's anywhere near what carriers have used traditionally, which is, I think, a big reason now in the spectrum frontier proceeding, the FCC is looking at, and the carriers are looking at, these very extremely high frequency millimeter wave bands, which are very wide, but they don't penetrate through obstacles. They don't go very far typically, except line of sight. So that's why certainly at least in the lower bands, the mid band and low band, you know, that where we've, you know, still, you know, do all of our connecting today. Sharing is really the future, and what the PCAST initially recommended, what the FCC adopted last year at 3.5 gigahertz, where it created the Citizens Broadband Radio Service, is really a great model for getting to spectrum abundance, and we could do it fairly quickly because there's quite a few bands. In fact, senators Thune and Nelson in their Mobile Now Act, which has been, you know, reported out of the Senate Commerce Committee already, it identifies the 3 gigahertz band from 3.1 all the way up to 4.2 as being a band where the commission could look at using this method. And in fact, the Citizens Broadband Service from 3550 to 3700 sits right in the middle of that band. And that was the short-term recommendation of PCAST, that band. And the PCAST even said that there's a potential spectrum superhighway on 3.1 to 4.2. And it's not because there aren't licensees. In fact, all of it's been assigned, either for light, either to federal use below 3.5 for private use above, but it's mostly empty. It's mostly not used. And you can have this this three-tier access system where you work around the incumbents using new techniques like the geolocation database, like spectrum sensing. At 3.5, the commission's adopted a plan that industry is in the process of implementing that we use both of those methods and allow opportunistic access by essentially unlicensed users too. So it's available interference-free to a degree to licensees while also being open access to many unlicensed users and protecting the incumbents from interference. So that's really it. This three-tier model, I think, is really the future for unlocking abundance without even needing to go up to these really, you know, bleeding edge high-tech frequencies.
Oh, thank you. We have a few more minutes, and I'd like to open it up to a few questions from the audience.
Earlier, the panel mentioned about quite a few buzzwords, IoT, and heard a few times, and also heard of visions or leadership. And 2 years ago, a similar panel on IoT on the in this forum mentioned about we can use in IPv4 using NATing to deploy IoT. And earlier the panel mentioned about 50 billion devices going to be connected to the internet. And have you ever talked about the underlying infrastructure required to make IoT a reality, which is the internet, and which is need to be upgraded from V4 to V6 simply because of the math does not work? And what is your comment on how your part of the world is going to deploy IPv6 to make IoT a reality? Thank you.
I bring a very pragmatic perspective to all this. Wi-Fi Alliance, admittedly, is an organization made up of engineers. We're not academicians. We're not policymakers. And so we look at these issues, precisely as they are, right? And we look at what problem it is that we need to solve and go about solving it. With regards to IPv6, it absolutely will be supported subsequently. Currently, we feel like with all of the different mechanisms, including network address translation and all sort of nesting, there isn't really an issue. Already today, there are 8 billion Wi-Fi devices in use. They're in use today. They include not just your laptop and your phone, but also your thermostat, your sprinkler system, your health device, your watch that you carry. There's tons of devices that operate perfectly fine today with an IPv4 model. However, IPv6 will continue to be an option that we'll be able to leverage when that's needed. I'll just mention that we are fully cognizant about the explosion of devices. In fact, this year the Wi-Fi industry is going to ship 3,000 million devices. So we're fully aware that the networks are getting very, very dense. In fact, the next version of Wi-Fi is 802.11ax that's coming. It's just starting to be developed, and it specifically targets optimization in extremely dense environments for the IoT era, right? One access point supporting thousands of endpoints, right? And so we're taking all of this into account already. So that would be sort of my response to that.
I think we have time for one more question, possibly.
Hi. I was just wondering what your thoughts are on some like emerging spectrum technologies like Li-Fi and what the potential benefits might be there. Are you familiar with Li-Fi using the visual spectrum?
I am, right. It's very nascent, right? And it's I suppose it's based on light impulses, and so it's in room only, right? Line of sight. It's You know, it's an example of innovation, you know, and we're always excited to see new things come along, right? You know, we're going to need the collective brain trust to address the explosion in demand for connectivity. So that's an area that we're absolutely tracking. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm also aware that, you know, satellite industry has kind of been looking into quantum entanglement for secure end-to-end communications. And so, when you talk about the quantum state, that presents some really interesting avenues, not just in computing, but also in communications. So it's pretty fascinating the next evolution of foundational technologies for communications will be. So with that, I'll turn it over to Tim, who has some last-minute housekeeping. Yes.
Thank you, Matt. Before I let Matt and the panel go, I think we have the next topic for Next Data Net Wireless, which is Li-Fi and quantum state of the net. But a very important announcement for any follower of the state of the net knows that anytime we host one of these things, we have biblical-type weather. And today we have gorgeous weather. So for the reception, we have a bar, full bar on the balcony right here and in the room behind you. And I want to thank our sponsors, IAB and Comcast. We want to thank Allison Remsen for jumping in, Edgar for getting out of biblical rain in Texas, Matt Hussey for a great panel, and Michael Calabrese. I want to thank everybody. Please, thank you so much for coming.